Recently, a friend of mine was shopping for a new chain and sprockets for his street bike, and he kept texting me questions. He wanted to know, how much do I spend? What brand chain should I get? What kind of masterlink do I buy? Should I get an aluminum sprocket or a steel sprocket? It turns out there are a lot of options. It's kind of like walking down the cereal aisle at your local supermarket. And I figured if he was confused by it, then other people probably are too. So today in RevZilla, I'm gonna walk you through all the choices you're gonna face when it comes time to replacing your drivetrain. Let's open up the shop manual. All right, maybe you've noticed that your chain has gotten rusty and kinked. If you're like most riders, you're gonna kick things off by shopping for a new chain. But let me just say that if your chain is worn out, then your sprockets are too, because everything wears together. You need to replace the front and rear sprockets and chain as a set. If you throw a new chain on 10,000 mile sprockets, even if they look pretty good, the chain is going to wear quickly, and that's definitely not good. With that out of the way, let's talk about chains. And the first thing is to be sure you are shopping for the correct size. Lucky for you, it's gonna be printed right on the outside links of your bike's existing chain. Common sizes are 520, 525, and 530, and while they all share the same pitch, that is the distance between the pins, they have different widths to accommodate different amounts of power. With the size selected, you now have to decide on a type of chain, and by that I mean unsealed or sealed. If you're anything like me, i.e. cheap, then you likely use price as a way to cull your options. But keep in mind that the really affordable, like sub $100 chains, are likely non-sealed, otherwise known as standard chains. There's nothing wrong with standard unsealed chains per se. In fact, they're still common on off-road bikes and small displacement street bikes, but they require a lot of lubrication and adjustment, and they just don't last very long. That's why I don't recommend them for use on your daily rider street bike. The next step up in the lowest grade I would recommend is a sealed O-ring chain. Sealed chains have O-rings pressed between the side plates that seals lubricating grease in and dirt and water out. They're much more durable and they're gonna last a lot longer than an unsealed chain. They also require less maintenance. It's probably what your bike came with, and generally speaking, it's gonna cost you about $100 to $130 to get a quality O-ring chain. Then there are X-ring, W-ring, and all kinds of end of the alphabet sealing technologies. Basically what you're paying for is a more complex and refined seal that will make the chain last longer and have less drag. Often these nicer chains will use higher quality materials. They might even have drilled side plates to make the chain lighter. And you usually see them labeled as premium or professional grade. They're expensive too, upwards of $150 to $200. Price is usually a pretty good indicator of a chain type. However, it's a good idea to read the product description to determine what kind of seal, if any, the chain has, because plenty of brands use confusing or suggestive model names. Speaking of names, I would suggest sticking to name brands like DID, RK, Vortex, and the like. I know those off brands can seem appealing because they're so cheap, but they are cheaper for a reason. It typically boils down to lower quality alloys and hardening treatments, as well as sloppier tolerances. Another thing to consider when buying a chain is the finish. Raw is the most affordable, but it's gonna rust the quickest if you forget to lube it. Plated gold or nickel chrome chains will resist corrosion the best, but that's only really a concern if you live near the ocean where the air is salty or where it rains a lot. Some brands even offer painted chains in every color of the rainbow in case you wanna be flashy. The length of your new chain is also something to consider, and that will be measured in number of links. Common options are even numbers, so 110 links, 112, 114, etc. If you have an owner's manual, it'll likely list the stock link count, or you can always count the links in the chain that's on your bike now. Okay, now for the master link, which is what's going to tie your new chain together. It's something a lot of people overlook, and while your new chain will likely come with a master link, it might be a clip type or a rivet type. Clip type links are easy to install and don't require any special tools beyond some pliers, but they're not as secure as rivet links since the clip can pop off. Rivet links need a special tool like this one to press the side plate on and mushroom the ends of the link pins, which makes it a very secure, very permanent installation. You can use the chain breaker to remove your old chain as well as remove lengths from a long chain, so I think it's worth investing in. Then again, I'm a tool nerd. Final thought about chains, I promise. Many of them come loaded up with grease, and that's from the grease bath they get during assembly at the factory. And a lot of people want to know, should they wipe it off or leave it on? I definitely suggest cleaning it off now, unless you would prefer to wipe it off of your wheels, bodywork, and boots later. And the best strategy is to gently heat the chain with a hairdryer to melt the grease, then wipe it off with a rag or a soft brush. Yes, it takes a little bit of elbow grease now, but it is well worth the effort. Okay, chains discussed ad nauseum. Now, it's onto the sprockets. For the rear sprocket, you're gonna be faced with the choice between lightweight aluminum and good old-fashioned steel. For street use, always, always, always go with steel. It is way more durable. Aluminum is appealing because it's light, you're gonna save a bunch of rotating and unsprung weight, but this stuff is soft and it's going to wear out very quickly. If you're committed to saving weight but don't want to compromise on durability, you could always get a Super Sprockets. That has a steel chainring mated to an aluminum carrier, so it's the best of both worlds. However, that's a $100 sprocket instead of a $45 sprocket like this one, so it's up to you to decide if it's worth it. Now for the front sprocket. There's often confusion because your OEM sprocket likely has rubber molded onto it, and the aftermarket parts you're looking at don't. That rubber is just there to act as a cushion for the chain to keep things quiet for noise testing. It doesn't do anything else. You're not likely to find that feature on aftermarket sprockets because of the cost and the complexity to manufacture it. Another thing to consider with replacement sprockets is tooth count. If you want to keep things simple and not risk throwing off your speedometer accuracy, I'd recommend sticking with the stock figures. You can check your manual for the front and rear tooth count, or it's usually stamped right there on the side of the sprockets. To reiterate, when it comes time to replace your drivetrain, you're gonna have to make some choices. You gotta decide the size of your chain, the type, the finish, the length, and the type of masterlink you're gonna go with. And obviously, if you're replacing your chain, you also need to replace your front and rear sprockets, at which point you gotta make a decision about material and tooth count. That's a lot of decisions to make, and if it seems overwhelming, bear in mind that you can always just buy OEM replacement parts or buy a chain and sprocket kit spec'd for your motorcycle. Well, there you go. That is a lot of information, and at least now you are somewhat familiar with the decisions you're gonna have to make when it comes time to buy some parts.